Hi, I'm Jared Kelly. I'm standing here outside Phoenix, Arizona, near the home of one of America's best private investors, because in just a moment, I'm going to share the deal of a lifetime. It's called a SPAC, a type of deal you've probably never seen before, which 99% of the public will never experience. An opportunity to invest in what could soon become the most exciting new company in America, essentially before it goes public, for as little as $10 a share. It's like a pre-IPO, but even better. Keep in mind, the man behind the SPAC we're sharing today is one of the most connected dealmakers in Hollywood. He's worked with Tom Cruise, Sylvester Stallone, Ron Howard. He helped relaunch the James Bond franchise. He's made billions for investors. An entrepreneur profiled by the New York Times for his massively successful multi-million dollar deals, and one type of deal in particular, pre-IPO shares. Getting early stakes in the best new companies before they go public for a legitimate chance to make 5 to 25 times your money before Wall Street has any clue. Today, he's agreed to share an exclusive new deal with our viewers through a unique type of investment vehicle called a SPAC, which could make you a lot more money than any stock, bond, crypto, IPO, or anything else you've ever seen before. His name is Harry Sloan. But here's the thing. Normally, it would be almost impossible for the average investor to meet with this level of entrepreneur one-on-one. I mean, this is the former CEO of the studio that produced Gone with the Wind and Wizard of Oz. His business partner is a former CBS executive and co-president of Sony Entertainment. These are busy guys. And that's what brings me here to Arizona. I've called in a favor and personally arranged a private meeting today with a former billion-dollar Wall Street hedge fund manager who can get us in the room with Harry. We call him the gatekeeper, and he'll share a way for you to immediately act on Harry's deal and buy shares in a new company, essentially before it goes public, if you're interested. As you're about to see, deals like this are where the real money is being made right now in the investment world. For example, consider 23andMe, the DNA testing kit company. It still hasn't gone public, but private investors have already made 1,288%. Or consider DoorDash, the food delivery company, which has done enormously well in the wake of COVID-19. Now, you can't buy shares on major exchanges, but private investors have already made 5,140%. And by the way, the last deal Harry put together could have quadrupled your money in just 6 months this year. In other words, why wait for an IPO when you could make 10 to 50 times more money by getting in before the company goes public? And here's the best part. Usually, Rule 501 of Regulation D won't let you anywhere near pre-IPO deals unless you're an accredited investor, which means you've had an income of at least $200,000 for 2 years. But with SPACs, all you need to get in is as little as $10. And that's because, unlike a traditional pre-IPO, a SPAC allows you to claim a stake in the best private companies without any of the usual paperwork or hassle of being a private investor. And incredibly, once you invest, you can even collect interest payments while you wait just for being involved. No other investment in the world allows you this much freedom with such huge potential. That's the beauty of SPACs, which Barron's recently described as the hottest new stocks of 2020. Even the Wall Street Journal called SPACs the hot IPO trend of 2020. Now look, we've spent months arranging a chance for you to meet the gatekeeper behind this deal who has all the information. He's one of America's leading experts on SPACs and has privately met with Harry Sloan to share this opportunity with you. So please, I urge you to take this deal seriously and act quickly, because once this company goes public and attracts attention, the biggest gains could be gone. In fact, the last time we shared this type of pre-IPO opportunity, which was back in December of 2019, you could have tripled your money in just 2 months. One man who shared his results with us was up nearly $10 million on our recommendation. So let me give you the full story, and then you can decide for yourself if this deal makes sense for you. Once you see how much money you could make on SPACs, I doubt you'll ever want to buy a regular stock again. Okay, here I am outside the gatekeeper's house. Now keep in mind, this guy spent 25 years on Wall Street, where he invested $250 million into pre-IPO deals, millions of his life savings, and has made multiple times his money on pre-IPOs in everything from biotech to apparel. Now, we call him the gatekeeper because he only allowed his clients into the best deals in America with an uncanny accuracy for filtering the thousands of new startups each year into only those with 10x potential. His name is Enrique Abella. His involvement in this space goes back decades. Throughout his career, he managed billions of dollars and was known for making money during every crisis of the past three decades. For example, he launched his first fund just 6 months before September 11th, launched his second fund 3 weeks before the 2008 crash, managed $200 million before the dot-com meltdown, and throughout, generated millions for his clients and helped raise about $6 billion altogether. Along the way, he saw gains like 788% in 10 months on General Growth Properties, 608% in 15 months on Vonage, and dozens more. Today, he's one of the most connected SPAC experts in America, a man whose network can get him direct access to some of the most successful and legendary investors in America, like billionaire Bill Ackman, who has agreed to join us today, billionaire John Malone, and of course, Hollywood legend and super entrepreneur Harry Sloan, whose upcoming private deal is our number one focus today. So come on, let's go inside. Enrique, I traveled more than 2,000 miles to be here, and I know you're extremely busy. So first, thanks for having me.
My pleasure, Jared. I'm really excited to share Harry and his partner's new SPAC with you. And I can tell you right now, if it's like the last deal they did a few months ago, our viewers could do extremely well. You could have quadrupled your money in just 6 months on that last deal.
Yeah, it's awesome. Now, I want to talk about the unique vehicle this deal will take, a SPAC, which has become a buzzword this year, right?
Jared, honestly, it's crazy. Everybody is talking about SPACs right now. It's by far the hottest investment vehicle on Wall Street this year. For example, Bill Ackman, who's going to join us later today, he's a billionaire who recently made almost a 10,000% gain during the coronavirus in what some are calling the greatest trade of all time. Today, Bill is now launching the largest SPAC in history.
Yeah, it's amazing. Now, for someone who's never heard of this type of deal before, can you walk us through it? From what I understand, a SPAC is similar to a pre-IPO, but a lot better. A chance for everyday folks to finally get a piece of the private market for that kind of 10-bagger potential that, you know, we hear about with companies like Airbnb and 23andMe. Is that about right?
Yes. The first thing to understand is this. What you're about to see is not a conventional stock, bond, ETF, option, crypto, IPO, or any asset like you've ever heard of before. SPACs are much different. They've actually existed for years, but as we'll explain, with the coronavirus coming along and crashing the stock market, they've soared in popularity. Already, you could have more than doubled your money on seven different SPACs recently. In some cases, made over four times your money. For example, take Virgin Galactic.
Yeah, let's talk about that. I mean, man, that was one of the best opportunities I've seen in my life.
Right, so for everyone watching, last December, I publicly recommended a company called Virgin Galactic. They work in a new industry called space tourism. Their customers pay $250,000 for trips into space on custom-made rockets, which sounds pretty far-fetched, right?
But not if you knew the executives, right?
Right. For me, one of my greatest resources is the network I built across 25-plus years on Wall Street. I got a call from a friend on Wall Street. This guy has managed billions for some of the most well-known hedge fund managers in history. He was a major shareholder in Virgin Galactic, and he explained to me why the company had 10 times potential upside. Within 45 minutes, my contact got me on a text message thread with the CEO, and I was invited down to New Mexico for a personal tour of their spaceport. And I realized two things. First, the company had already sold about $150 million worth of trips into space, and second, the company had been private for years, which means for most of this firm's existence, you couldn't buy the stock.
But that was by choice, right?
Right. The founder, billionaire Richard Branson, did not want to take the company public, at least not the old-fashioned way. Mostly because launching an IPO is incredibly expensive and time-consuming. So we worked out a deal with a small group of very successful private investors, in particular a young billionaire venture capitalist who was an early executive at Facebook. If you'd known this guy and gotten into this deal, you could have gotten a stake in Virgin Galactic before it went public for just 10 bucks a share. It's a vehicle known as a SPAC. And when I discovered and vetted this SPAC back in December 2019, I told everyone who would listen to buy immediately.
Yeah, including me. Got in a week after your recommendation. It was fantastic.
And how'd you do?
Well, I mean, the thing skyrocketed. Sold a quarter of my position for an 800% gain, just to take some profit off the table. But then I sold another quarter for 10 times my money, and I'm letting the rest ride. You know, for me, it was all really impressive because first time buying a SPAC really kind of threw me. It was fun. It was interesting. And folks, that's why we're here today. You see, part of my job is sorting through the hundreds of emails that we get from our readers each week. And man, after Enrique told us about that SPAC deal on Virgin Galactic, the notes poured in from our readers. For example, Tony B. wrote, "I've made over 100% on Virgin Galactic. Good call." Robert B. wrote, "I'm up over $32,000 on my Virgin Galactic investment." And check this out. Bill B. sent us a note saying he had taken a huge position in Enrique's Virgin Galactic recommendation and was currently up nearly $10 million. Assuming he held onto his stake, by early July, he would have been up an extraordinary $29 million.
Yeah, all thanks to a SPAC, a way to essentially get into a private deal pre-IPO, but with a much, much quicker and easier path to making money. And that's why I think this newest deal from Harry Sloan, which we're sharing with you today, has a chance to go down as one of the best investment opportunities you'll see for decades. It could even be better than Virgin Galactic.
Now, why do you say that?
There's a secret to making money on private deals. For me, it all goes back to an experience I had about 5 years ago. You see, at the time, I was managing more than $1 billion on Wall Street, and one morning, a colleague pulled me aside and said, "Enrique, a friend of mine has started up a new company. It's going to be huge. Want to invest?" And my reaction was very foolish. I told him, "Absolutely not. No way."
You just didn't trust the guy, or?
Yeah, I trusted him, but at that point in my career, I'd made enough money that I was constantly getting pitched on private investments. Everyone and their brother wanted me to invest in their special deal. In this case, the company founder was making a type of clothing. He had the gall to think that he could launch a multi-million dollar online apparel company.
It's not exactly a cutting-edge product.
Yeah, right. So I thought, forget it. I can do much better by just investing in public companies, which I've been doing my whole career. There are tons of companies like Liberty Global, DirecTV, and Bharti Airtel, where I've made 100, 200% of my money in less than 24 months. So why mess around with a little apparel company? But the guy was pretty persistent. Then 6 months later, he came back to me and said their sales had increased sixfold. They were selling $6 million worth of apparel products online, but it wasn't too late for me to get a pre-IPO share.
That's pretty impressive.
Yeah. So I thought, what the hell? I put in $25,000. My biggest regret, I should have invested 10 times that amount. That apparel company has since become the most successful retailer of its kind. It still hasn't gone public, but I've already made nearly 10 times my money on part of my private investment, and I've got a 15-bagger on the remaining part of my stake. For me, this was a real total game changer.
Right. I mean, you know, some of the biggest and fastest gains are now happening outside the stock market before the company goes public.
Yeah, and we're seeing this in every sector. Consider Credit Karma, for example. It's not a public company, but that hasn't stopped private investors from buying pre-IPO shares, which are up 46,800%. Or consider Airbnb. Despite its popularity, the company still hasn't gone public, but you could have made an already 524,900% gain on pre-IPO shares.
Yeah, and the sad part is most ordinary investors will never get the chance to see these kinds of opportunities. The Wall Street system just wants them to keep buying regular IPOs and stocks because that leaves all the biggest gains for Wall Street.
Yeah, the unfortunate reality is unless you're super connected and know the best deal makers, you're simply never going to hear about the best private deals, period. And frankly, that's where a guy like me comes in. Because again, Jared, there's a secret to doing this the right way. It's how I personally am up 4 times my money on a pre-IPO shares in a private eyeglass company, up 300% on pre-IPO shares in a mental health company with a 50-to-1 potential payoff, and more. In fact, the secret I'm going to share today is why I've been involved in many different startups today, and while I recently invested over $1.5 million of my own money into a digital media startup. But today, right now, it's your turn. I'm going to share an opportunity that's even better than a pre-IPO with none of the usual hurdles to getting in, and all thanks to my meeting with Harry Sloan, a Hollywood legend.
And again, this deal is made possible by a newly popular and previously rare investment vehicle known as a SPAC, a private deal that works like investing in a company pre-IPO, but with a far quicker and easier path to making money. Now, Enrique, I know we're going to talk about exactly how SPAC investing works, why Harry Sloan, the former CEO of MGM, launched a new SPAC recently, and why you believe it could go down as one of the most successful investment opportunities that we've shared in 20 years. Let's start with a simple question. What's the difference between a SPAC and investing in a traditional company pre-IPO?
Well, the problem with private pre-IPOs like 23andMe and DoorDash is that it's a huge headache to invest. The SEC demands pre-IPO investors be accredited, which means extremely wealthy. Plus, you have to deal with lawyers, confidentiality agreements, a ton of paperwork. SPACs are simply a lot more accessible, just as lucrative, and far less risky. All you need is as little as $10, no matter what your net worth or background. You can collect interest payments while you wait for a huge payoff. And you get the same upside potential as traditional pre-IPOs with just a click in your brokerage account. Now, I want to be clear, not every SPAC trades at the same price. Today, we're sharing a number of SPACs that launched at around $10. Some will be more expensive, others will be less expensive.
Now, I know SPACs have been doing extremely well this year, especially in the wake of the coronavirus. It seems like dozens of companies a month are choosing to go public through a SPAC rather than through a traditional IPO. The gains have just been ridiculous. I mean, 670% gains in 5 months on Nikola, 214% gains in 21 days on Tortoise, 98% in less than a month on Graph Industrial, and many more. But let's get one thing straight. Isn't it sort of, scary to be getting into these private deals when, you know, the 99% of the public just has no clue these vehicles even exist?
If you remember one thing I say today, let it be this. Nowadays, if you want to make real money in the investment world, you're making a huge mistake if you only look at regular companies on the stock market. You're missing out on some of the biggest gains. Take Uber, for example. Remember how excited everyone was when it went public last year?
Yeah, I mean, the New York Times called it, the biggest Silicon Valley IPO or initial public offering in years.
Well, the stock's been a huge disappointment. Take a look. You'd have lost money on the IPO. So what happened? How could such a popular company deliver such mediocre investment returns to public investors?
Well, early investors had probably made most of the money already, right?
Exactly. Uber's not a young company. It went public in 2019, but it's been around as a private investment since 2010. That's almost a decade. And during that time, pre-IPO shares rose almost 1,000,000%. In other words, private investors sucked out all of the upside of this company. And by the time it went public, all you got were the leftovers.
So explain for us how that's possible. I mean, Uber didn't change when it went public, right? I mean, it still offered the same popular service.
Sure, but a lot of the opportunity had already been realized. Take a look. According to Goldman Sachs, firms that are less than 5 years old before they go public have average sales growth of nearly 50% over five quarters, compared to just 19% for firms older than 15 years. And that's a huge problem for everyday Americans, because the fact is companies are waiting longer than ever to go public nowadays. Now, look at this. Today, the average company waits 12 years to go public, compared to just 4 years back in 99. And when companies do finally go public, the average market cap is 8 times more expensive than it was 40 years ago.
So throughout those years of being private, the companies experience their highest growth and deliver the returns of that growth back to the private investors who are probably all super connected, right? I mean, like these Silicon Valley, insiders and company founders.
Right. When you buy a regular IPO, you're not really anywhere near the ground floor. Tons of rich, connected people got in ahead of you. Look at Peloton, the exercise bike company. It was one of 2019's most anticipated IPOs, and the stock has more than doubled. Not bad, but if you could have bought a pre-IPO share as early as 2012, 7 years earlier, you'd have made 5,676% during that time. Private investors literally made 30 times more money, which doesn't really seem fair if you think about it.
Yeah, I saw a story on CNBC about this. It was all about how many, in so many ways, companies don't need to go public anymore. They can easily raise money from private investors. They don't need the cash that comes from an IPO. So it's like, why bother going public at all?
Yeah, the reality is there simply aren't as many high growth opportunities for the general public anymore. Consider this. According to a Credit Suisse study, there are fewer companies publicly trading today than there were 40 years ago. So there's more money chasing less opportunity in today's stock market.
It just seems incredibly sad for like the everyday American.
One expert has even said policymakers should democratize the stock market to fix all this. And that's because 90% of IPOs are nothing more than a payday for the private investors who got in at the beginning. A legal transfer of wealth from the everyday American hoping to get rich to folks who already are. Is that fair? Absolutely not. Look, I come from a really poor background. My family and I lived in a station wagon behind a flea bag motel in Phoenix at one point when I was a kid. I don't think it's right that only super rich private investors have access to the best high growth companies at the earliest stages, while everyone else is left with the scraps that go to the public.
Yeah, I mean, and the examples go on. I mean, software company Slack waited 10 years to go public. And during that time, private investors enjoyed all of its early stage growth, saw 491% gain on the pre-IPO shares. But after finally going public in 2019, stock's been pathetic. It's shown the public a negative 25% return. You'd have been better off keeping your money in a zero interest savings account.
Bottom line is this, Jared. Traditional IPOs just aren't what they used to be. And that's why we're here today. Pre-IPOs and private deals are now the best way to get a ground floor stake in exciting new companies where many of the best years of sales growth are still ahead of them. Growth that you enjoy as a shareholder. And today you can get a stake in one of the best opportunities I've seen in my two decade career for just 10 bucks a share. Essentially, before it goes public. And you don't need to be rich or connected to get in or go through any of the hassle of a traditional pre-IPO. It's all through a powerful and little known investment vehicle known as a SPAC.
That's excellent. Now, folks, as we're going to show you in a moment, each SPAC is created by a deal maker. And the most successful of these deal makers are often people Enrique personally knows or can easily access. For example, the Virgin Galactic SPAC was spearheaded by a 43-year-old billionaire from Silicon Valley. When the electric truck maker Nikola went public through a SPAC this year, it was led by a former General Motors executive, someone Enrique had known for almost 25 years. The online gambling platform DraftKings just went public through a SPAC co-founded by a Hollywood billionaire named Jeff Sagansky. Who's partnering on the new deal we're sharing with you today, and so on. So let's dive in and talk about the man responsible for the brand new SPAC that we're sharing with you right now, one of Enrique's contacts whose deal you could buy into with your brokerage account immediately if you're interested. Meet Harry Sloan. He's a founding shareholder of the famous film company Lionsgate and former CEO of legendary Hollywood studio MGM, where he personally oversaw the sequel to the blockbuster movie The Terminator, starring Arnold Schwarzenegger. Prior to that, he built a broadcasting business in Europe that he sold back in 2005 for $2.6 billion, personally pocketing $200 million on the deal. The Los Angeles Times once summed up his career in one sentence: Harry likes to win.
And Jared, one thing I'll tell you right now about Harry, he's a serial entrepreneur with a drive like you've never seen. He once did a deal for a film studio where they invested $2 million and eventually sold for $300 million, a 14,900% return. He partnered on taking sports betting company DraftKings public this year, one of the most successful SPAC deals of all time. As the former chairman of CBS once said, it's unwise to bet against someone as determined as Harry.
Yeah, and I believe it.
Today, this new opportunity of Harry's could be one of the best investments you ever see in your life, especially if you get in right now. Today, I mean, imagine buying pre-IPO shares in Tesla, back when Elon Musk first dreamed up the idea. That's the kind of opportunity we're sharing today.
Okay, so let's get a few things straight. In short, Harry is about to take a company public, and instead of an IPO, it'll go through a special vehicle, a vehicle most people have no clue even exists, called a SPAC. This allows you to quickly and easily buy shares of a private company that could soon have worldwide appeal, with all its years of highest sales growth still ahead of it, and get paid alongside Harry himself. When Harry makes money, you make money.
And Jared, keep in mind, that's one of the best parts of a private deal. You get to invest along some of the smartest company founders in the world and essentially ride their coattails. For example, we've all heard of Lyft, the car sharing company, right? Well, it's no surprise the founder has made $695 million. But one guy, Sean Aggarwal, happened to meet the founder early on. And he told the CEO somewhat famously, "I'm not sure about this carpool thing," but he invested anyway, and he walked away with $117 million.
Nice payday.
What you're about to see is the closest you can get to investing alongside a brilliant founder before the general public has any clue the company exists, for just $10 a share in many cases.
And with that, let's get into exactly how this whole deal works. In short, the deal we're sharing today is known as a SPAC, short for Special Purpose Acquisition Company. Often known as blank check companies, these vehicles are essentially a backdoor into the private market. They allow anyone to invest in some of the best private companies for as little as $10, essentially before they go public. Enrique, walk us through an example from 2020.
Sure. Consider this. One of the hottest trends in America right now is the electric car. For example, Tesla is one of the most talked about and best performing stocks in financial history, up more than 10,000% over the past decade. Imagine privately investing before that stock went public. Well, earlier this year, you could have bought private shares in one of the world's newest electric car makers through a SPAC. In this case, it was created by a legendary deal maker. My old contact, Steve Gursky, the former vice chairman of General Motors, cut a deal with a popular startup that makes electric trucks and took the company public on May 3rd. The stock is called Nikola, and the ticker is today NKLA. But here's the thing. Before the company went public, you could have bought a share for just $10 through the SPAC that made it possible, Vecto IQ. That means you would have received shares in Nikola before it began trading and made three times your money before it even went public. And then when the company officially went public, you could have made a total of six times your money in just another 2 weeks. In other words, you could have turned every $5,000 you invested into $30,000 and gotten in before most people had ever even heard of this electric truck startup.
And that's all thanks to a SPAC.
All thanks to a SPAC, right. In a nutshell, here's how it works. The best deal makers in America are often retired CEOs, the kind of guys who made millions running companies like Johnson & Johnson, McDonald's, you name it.
And you have access to a lot of these executives, right?
Across my decades-long career, I've gone out of my way to build relationships with some of the most successful business people and entrepreneurs out there. Even after retirement, they continue making deals. Take a guy like Jim Kilts, for example.
Yeah, tell everyone who that is.
Kilts is the former CEO of Gillette, who negotiated its sale to Procter & Gamble for $57 billion. He pocketed $165 million on the deal. Now, for most people, that's enough. After a score like that, you retire and go lay on a beach.
I'm guessing not Jim.
No, and that's where SPACs come in. They can be a great opportunity for retired CEOs looking for an entrepreneurial opportunity. A SPAC is a holding company. It doesn't have any business operations. It's just a pool of cash run by a really smart deal maker who's looking to invest that pool of cash and make 5 or 10 times his initial investment without doing any of the hard work himself. He simply looks around the private market, finds the absolute best business possible, and then he does something very simple. He buys it. And by buying it, the company instantly goes public.
How can a company, though, instantly go public? I'm missing that piece.
That's the heart of this entire opportunity. You see, traditional IPOs are rapidly declining. And one reason is a lot of companies don't want to go through the hassle of an IPO anymore. You have to deal with lawyers, the roadshow, a complete audit, and so on. It can take years to go public and cost millions of dollars. And by the way, with the volatility caused by the recent stock market crash and the threat of a recession, a lot of companies can't do an IPO right now, even if they wanted to. We'll cover that in a minute. So Wall Street launched a vehicle called Special Purpose Acquisition Companies that do nothing but collect cash from investors. These companies are already public. They're essentially just pools of cash with their own stock ticker and no business operations whatsoever. They're run by brilliant CEOs. And their entire purpose is to simply acquire a great private business with all of their cash. When they do, the company they acquire instantly inherits their position on the stock market and basically goes public.
Wow, so it's a backdoor into the stock market.
Absolutely. Take a company like Airbnb, for example. They're still a private company. Mm-hmm. But if a SPAC came along and acquired them, Airbnb would instantly be a public company with its own stock ticker, literally overnight. And that convenience is one reason why this year alone, 41 SPACs have already hit the market, accounting for nearly half of all money raised for IPOs in 2020.
Okay, so going back to Jim Kilts, the former CEO of Gillette, he's been involved in creating SPACs?
Exactly. Back in 2016, he had his own SPAC called Conyers Acquisition Corp. He was looking for a deal and came across a private company that makes protein bars. Actually, the company founded by Robert Atkins, the guy who started the Atkins diet.
The low-carb diet.
Exactly. For a while, the Atkins diet was all the rage. Atkins' company made a lot of money selling low-carb foods. So here comes Jim Kilts looking for a deal. He sees the Atkins company, and right away, he knows it's a high-profit business he could expand by hiring all the right people. So boom, his SPAC acquired it, and the company went public. And just like that, anyone who'd already invested with Jim would have instantly received shares in Robert Atkins' company before it went public and before it received its own stock ticker. Today it trades as the Simply Good Foods Company, ticker SMPL. As a SPAC investor, you'd have gotten in while the company was still private and paid a little over $10 a share. By the time it attracted major attention, you could have more than tripled your money.
Okay, but wait a minute. A blank check company. So some critics might say, if these companies are just a pool of cash, why would I invest? I mean, how do I know a deal is actually going to get done?
Remember, you're not investing in any private business up front. You're investing with the deal maker. You're handing him your cash and saying, go make a deal. And here's the best part. He's legally required to make a deal within a specified period of time. While he looks for a target, the money you invest is held in an interest-bearing account. If he doesn't make a deal, you can get most of your money back based on the amount of your initial investment, plus interest. And once he finds a target, you have a decision to make. He tells you which company he wants to buy and take public, and it's your choice whether you choose to stay invested. So with the example I just showed you, if you decided not to invest in Robert Atkins' company, you could have just cashed out and walked away with a good part of your original stake, plus interest. See the difference between that and a traditional pre-IPO share where you can lose everything?
Yeah, I mean, normally when you invest in private equity, you're locked in. Once you buy the pre-IPO, there's no going back. And that's assuming you even qualify to begin with. But with SPACs, anyone can get into the deal, and you can sell anytime, and you can even veto the deal maker if you choose.
You can veto putting your own personal cash in, get your money back, collect your interest, and walk away. As Barron's recently put it, waiting for the deal to get done is as nearly a risk-free arbitrage opportunity that is out there. That's what I love about SPACs. Think about the last time you bought a regular stock based on some exciting story, a new gold discovery or some hot new technology gadget or whatever. How many times have you lost money when the story turned out to be complete BS? SPACs are different. As the Wall Street Journal writes, SPACs have a built-in safeguard that allows investors to redeem their shares before an acquisition goes through. That means investors can avoid getting hurt by bad deals.
And people actually do that? They veto the deal?
Hey, it's your money and your choice. As the Wall Street Journal recently reported, if SPAC common shareholders don't like the deal, the overwhelming majority of them will happily take their $10 cash and trust back plus interest rather than stick around and hold on to shares in the acquisition target. Often, though, it's a mistake to cash out. For example, I heard from one man who got into the SPAC deal I shared last December and told me he was holding over a 300% return on Virgin Galactic.
And then once the deal goes through, when am I allowed to sell the stock?
You can cash out at any time, before or after the SPAC deal announces. It's just a click or two away in your brokerage account like any normal stock. That's the biggest difference between a SPAC and traditional pre-IPO shares trading on the private market, where the risk is far higher, because a lot of those startups go bankrupt, taking all their investors with them. In fact, some people like to sell half their SPAC shares when the price doubles, which we've seen over and over again this year. That way, you can let the rest of it ride for the long term, like playing with house money.
Now, Enrique, one big question is, why are SPACs so popular right now? I mean, according to one study I saw, the volume of SPAC IPOs increased 500% from 2012 to 2019. And halfway into this year alone, the SPAC market had already had its largest size ever at more than $21 billion.
Yeah, one of the reasons is the coronavirus. The pandemic has actually improved the SPAC market, which makes sense. Traditional IPOs rely on market timing. They do best in a roaring bull market, which means all the volatility caused by the coronavirus has led to a massive drop in public offerings this year. Remember, IPO deals often fall apart even during the best of times. Bankers haggle over the valuation, the CEO gets cold feet, private investors pull out. All kinds of things can go wrong with a traditional IPO deal. So as you can imagine, with all of the uncertainty in today's coronavirus economy, private investors and banks are more reluctant than ever to take an unknown company public.
Got it. So if I'm growing a successful company, looking to raise cash right now, and nobody on Wall Street will take me public, SPACs are essentially the perfect backdoor for that.
Exactly. And this isn't a secret. The Wall Street Journal recently ran a full profile of SPACs, writing, "Fallout from the coronavirus has fueled a fresh wave of interest in an unusual investment vehicle, the blank check company. It is a backdoor way of doing an initial public offering. And with the IPO market rattled by COVID-19 and wild volatility, it has become a more attractive way to go public."
Well, that explains the numbers. Dealogic recently reported that IPOs in the US raised $2.6 billion in a single recent month. Of that, $2.2 billion went to SPACs. In other words, in just 1 month this year, 80% of all money raised for US initial public offerings went to these blank check firms, compared with an average of 9% over the past decade.
Yeah, because keep in mind, a lot of great companies have been hurt by the coronavirus. If they tried to IPO right now, they wouldn't be valued nearly as high as they would have just a year ago. Wall Street simply can't provide them with the cash they need to keep growing, so they're turning to SPACs. As Yahoo Finance recently reported, SPAC deal makers say the coronavirus pandemic may explain why there's been an uptick in SPAC activity this year. As private company valuations fall and they look for liquidity, SPACs could fill a void left by traditional IPOs.
And then, of course, the other big benefit for a company is it's much easier to go public through a SPAC than a regular IPO, right? I mean, I saw this Bloomberg write-up that SPACs are substantially quicker, taking only a few months as opposed to up to a year if a company follows the full traditional IPO process.
Absolutely. You skip the entire regulatory headache of preparing to go public. As the Virgin Galactic CEO told Fortune magazine, it required less managerial bandwidth and less time, frankly. And remember, Nikola, the electric tuck maker whose SPAC would have made you 6 times your money in 4 months? Mm-hmm. The company's CFO recently told the Wall Street Journal, "We chose the SPAC route because there was simply too much uncertainty in the market with the coronavirus. If we had pursued the IPO path, we wouldn't be a public company at this point."
That's crazy.
Yeah. In the meantime, certain companies are desperate for cash right now. And if there's one thing SPACs can provide, it's cash. So SPACs are the ultimate solution for a small company that can't afford to go public right now. In fact, one company, a tiny little online car retailer that got hit hard by the coronavirus, recently went from having to lay off some of their employees to being on the verge of going public just 4 months later through a SPAC. And now they're stronger than ever.
And it's a win-win for SPAC investors too, right? I mean, because SPACs are now buying up high-quality companies like that at bargain rates.
Absolutely. The popularity of SPACs isn't just from companies who can't IPO the old-fashioned way. It's from smart deal makers who realize this market is offering trophy assets at a fraction of the normal price. For an investor, it's the difference between buying a company like Airbnb at, say, 50 a share when it goes public versus claiming a stake at 10 bucks a share when the company is still private. That's how you get rich on IPOs. One study even said outright, SPACs are dominating the IPO scene, and some investors believe a recession could lead to more of them.
Which is great if you can access the best deal makers.
Well, fortunately I can. And nobody understands how to take advantage of a situation like this better than Harry Sloan, the deal maker behind the SPAC we're sharing today. He spent years as a Hollywood executive, a cutthroat business. You've seen the movie Rocky, right?
Yeah, of course. Sylvester Stallone, the Italian Stallion.
Right. Well, check this out. In the 2000s, Stallone was considered box office poison. In fact, he later told the LA Times, "Selling me at that time was no easy task. You would have had better luck selling Anthrax in a Pez dispenser." But that didn't stop Harry. He realized a bargain when he saw it, picked up Stallone for next to nothing, and released the blockbuster sequel, Rocky Balboa.
Oh, I love it. And he's applying the same mindset to the market, I'm assuming?
You bet he is. Right now, there are thousands of companies who've had near-death experiences. They're desperate for cash, and financing is near zero. It's the perfect environment for this type of deal. This is unfortunate for those companies, but a great opportunity for SPAC deal makers. A crashing stock market, an economic recession, a pandemic, riots in the street, any bad thing that comes along will eventually end up working in their favor. This is one of the biggest advantages of the business model.
One question. With Harry's success in Hollywood, is his new company some kind of entertainment business, like a new Netflix or some kind of new streaming platform?
Well, I'm glad you asked that question, because the answer points to the entire secret of making money on deals like this. And the secret is this. Forget about what the company does. That's not the first consideration. Now, I realize that's a lot different than ordinary stocks, where you'd only invest if the company has some fantastic new product or service. But with SPACs, what matters most is the deal maker. How good is he at getting deals done?
Okay, but Enrique, you've worked with a lot of brilliant people. Why a Hollywood executive? I mean, I would think Wall Street contacts would be better at putting together SPACs.
I know a lot of smart people in finance for sure. There were the So's trading bandits back in the late 90s, for instance. Imagine making $50 million right out of college. That's...
Hold on. What's a So bandit?
Back in the late 90s, the NASDAQ had something known as the Small Order Execution System, or SOES. Some friends of mine figured out how to game the system and get a slight advantage over every single trade from an institution.
That doesn't sound legal.
Well, it was, although funny enough, those traders were later called the SOES bandits. My friends personally pocketed something like $50 million right out of Wharton Business School doing that. Eventually, the loophole closed. I know a lot of guys like this doing great stuff today, but I think Harry is in the best position to create one of the best SPAC opportunities.
Gotcha. So to make money with SPACs, you got to get in with a smart deal maker. That's the key.
It's an absolute must. And not only that, but you should be able to pick up the phone and talk to him. Luckily for me, I've worked long enough in the hedge fund world, managing more than $1 billion, to enjoy that kind of access. For example, I've had the chance to meet Dr. John Malone a half a dozen times over the past 20 years. He's a multi-billionaire and the largest landowner in the United States.
That's crazy. How are you able to make these connections?
If you want to make serious money in the investment world, one of the most important things you can do is build your network. I'm constantly talking to CEOs and visiting headquarters. For example, one of my old Wharton friends is the head of investment banking for SPACs at an active brokerage. And one of my fraternity brothers trades one of the largest SPAC portfolios on Wall Street.
And of all the brilliant minds you could tap right now, Harry Sloan is the man that we should all be listening to.
Absolutely. Again, this guy is one of the best entrepreneurs I've ever seen. And he has a big stake in this deal himself, so he's determined to make money. And get this, his business partner is Jeff Sagansky, the former president of CBS. He and Jeff both ran a SPAC recently, took the online gaming platform DraftKings public. If you'd gotten in, you could have turned every $5,000 investment into $20,000 since it went public earlier this year. A deal so successful that it's been profiled by the Wall Street Journal, CNBC, Fortune magazine, and more. And now, today, Jeff has partnered with Harry on his newest SPAC, like the half dozen others they've done together. The one we're urging you to buy immediately. And remember, once you invest, if you don't like Harry's new company, if you don't like the business he's taking public through the SPAC, you can get your investment back with interest.
Yeah, to me, that's just incredible. So you can get back every penny you invest if you just don't like the deal, right?
Right. Once you invest, your money is held in an escrow account earning interest. As soon as Harry announces a deal, he takes a vote among shareholders. If you're in favor of moving forward, you can stay invested and earn interest on your investment once the company is acquired. If you're not in favor, you cash out. That means you'll get most of the money back you invested. Now, as we mentioned before, we can't guarantee that it will be $10 for every SPAC. Some deals have different rules. And to most people, all of this sounds too good to be true.
Yeah.
But that's because they don't understand the vehicle behind it. Again, it's not an ordinary stock, which is one more reason why SPACs are so popular right now. If we see another crash this year, you're far better off with a SPAC than a popular blue chip.
Yeah, that's a good point. When a day like March 16th, 2020 comes along, valuations of private companies don't change at all, right?
Well, you can't trade out of a private investment as easily as publicly traded stocks. That means you're protected from some of the emotional hysteria that causes market crashes. I mean, March 16th was one of the worst one-day drops in market history.
It was
right?
The worst, right?
Yeah. Lowe's, Boeing, and Capital One all fell 20% or more among dozens of others. But look at private company Palantir, a software firm that's shown early investors an 11,280% gain. Its value didn't change one penny that day. And frankly, Jared, most private investors are smart enough to realize that a great business will remain a great business despite the latest piece of bad news to hit the economy.
But in this case, you're not locked in forever.
No, of course not. You see, SPACs offer a major advantage over traditional pre-IPOs. In short, you can sell your position at any time you'd like, as easily as a stock, even if the company being targeted is still private. And the value of the target company won't change as much in a crash. That's why companies love SPACs. Instead of haggling over their value with investment bankers, they get essentially a blank check, right? The entire value of the SPAC. For example, Bill Ackman is now launching a $4 billion SPAC, the largest ever. That's essentially a $4 billion blank check he can cut to any company he wants to take public.
I love this. So you can buy and sell shares to your heart's content before or after the company goes public.
Right, and those shares are always just 10 bucks at the beginning. As Barron's recently put it, SPACs give investors a chance to get on the ground floor of a new stock with daily liquidity and a guaranteed redemption value.
And it seems like more and more companies are, and these deal makers, are getting involved in this space every day. I saw Goldman Sachs just raised $700 million for a new SPAC. The former CEO of Honeywell, former Citigroup executive, even the vice chairman of the New York Stock Exchange just said SPACs are now larger and have some of the most well-known business leaders sponsoring them, which makes them more attractive to investors.
Sure. The whole entire secret is hearing about the best deal makers who don't advertise this stuff. If you know the SPAC space and the deal makers like I do, you can actually discover a lot of these opportunities before almost anyone else knows about them. And that's why this opportunity is so rare today. We've essentially cut to the front of the line. to help you learn about this deal today, right now, before 99% of the general public has any clue it exists, if you're interested.
Yeah, I mean, I love this deal. So tell us a little bit more about Harry SPAC.
No,
I'm sorry, what do you mean?
Well, we've put together a special report detailing everything you need to know about Harry's target company, but I don't want to share that just yet. Harry and his partner are in the process right now of finalizing the deal with the company they're planning to take public. Typically, a SPAC doesn't ever want to announce the deal until after all the negotiations with the target company are complete. Otherwise, it could cause the SPAC share price to spike before a deal officially goes through.
Oh, right. Didn't that actually just happen with an electric car maker?
Sure did. In early July, one SPAC shot up 71% based on nothing more than a rumor that it was targeting Fisker, an automaker that's looking to produce electric SUVs.
And that rumor turned out to not even be correct, right?
Right. Bloomberg said the whole thing could be a case of mistaken identity, but that didn't stop the SPAC from almost doubling overnight. The only difference is, by buying the SPAC right now, before the deal is common knowledge, you could see the price of your shares skyrocket as soon as the deal is all over the media.
Yeah, and that's no joke. I mean, DraftKings, the SPAC launched by Harry and his business partner, almost doubled on news of the deal itself, right? And I saw another SPAC, Landcadia Holdings, popped 38% in just 8 hours after their deal was announced.
Right. So don't wait for the details of which company they're targeting to act on this deal. Like I said earlier, it's all about the deal maker, trusting that Harry is going to buy a fantastic company, which I'm sure he will.
And Enrique, you know from your own personal experience, I'm sure, right?
Yeah, I met Harry years ago on Wall Street. Absolutely brilliant guy. He was doing a roadshow for a satellite company he was taking public, which ended up doing very well for investors. I kept in touch with him and his business partner, Jeff, ever since. They're both among the leading SPAC deal makers in America.
And speaking of that, in the past few weeks, you've met with almost a dozen of the wealthiest, most successful SPAC deal makers to find the absolute best deal to share with us today, right?
That's true. Just recently, we spoke with Bill Ackman, Jim Ross, and Mark Gerhard, and other high-quality SPAC sponsors. They told me more about SPACs and upcoming SPAC deals than you'll hear about almost anywhere in America. I mean, these are the guys who are personally assembling the biggest deals right now. And remember, we'll be holding a Q&A with Bill Ackman in just a moment. He'll be zooming in from his headquarters. And even better, I've compiled the best of everything to share with you right now, before even 99% of Wall Street has any clue.
Yeah, excellent. Thank you, Enrique. And that brings us to the biggest question you probably have right now. In short, how can you get into this deal today? Well, as he mentioned, Enrique has just prepared a new research report that explains the full situation. It's called SPACs: How to Make 5 to 10 times Your Money with the Best Private Deals. Inside this report, you'll learn exactly how to buy shares of Harry Sloan's new SPAC deal right now, no matter what your net worth or background. You'll learn how SPACs work, and best of all, you'll also receive access to an exclusive video interview with Harry Sloan and Jeff Sagansky, the two businessmen who are putting this deal together.
Yeah, I sat down recently with Harry and Jeff and filmed an inside look at exactly what their new SPAC could accomplish. Again, I can't share details here in public, but this behind-the-scenes video puts you in the room with these two multimillionaire SPAC investors yourself, so you can learn everything you need to know directly from them.
And of course, Harry and Jeff are longtime contacts of yours.
Yes, we got unique access to their insights and how they're looking to create a blockbuster investment opportunity.
I mean, normally you'd have to have a large investment, be a large investment institution.
Hold on, Jared, let me interrupt. One thing I forgot to mention, in our new report on this deal, you'll also learn about the best part of it all. It's something we haven't covered yet. In short, for every share you buy before the company goes public, you'll receive a free investment that can make you even more money. It's called a warrant.
Yeah, this is exactly how I made my money in the Virgin Galactic investment. Tell everybody what a warrant is.
To put it simply, for every 5 or 10% stock gain, a warrant will typically increase 2 or 3 times that amount. It's like a stock option you automatically receive as a SPAC investor, which could hand you an extra 100% or more. For example, consider DraftKings, the company that Harry and Jeff recently took public through a SPAC. The stock quadrupled in 6 months, as we mentioned earlier, but the warrants did even better. They returned 2,163% in the same time frame. In other words, you'd have received an extra 22 times your money in addition to the 300% gainer you had made on the stock.
Yeah, and again, let me just jump in here and say, when I bought the Virgin Galactic SPAC, specifically invested in the warrants, which made me 8 and 10 times my money on a part of the position, eight times the money on part and then 10 times the money on a different part.
Now, Jared, here's the cool part. Typically, you have to buy a warrant separately from the stock. But with almost every SPAC, you receive a free warrant with every share you buy if you get in before the company goes public. Sometimes we'll recommend buying the warrant outright, even after the deal goes through. My new research report will explain exactly how this works and how to use this extra feature to maximize your gains. But one thing I need to make very clear, Harry has a lot of investment vehicles out there, and we're focused on just one of them, which we'll share with you.
Yeah, that's a really important point, Enrique. Harry is a serial entrepreneur who have dozens of deals in the works at any given time. Without a report, you could end up buying the wrong investment by accident, which could be a costly mistake.
Yeah, if you're serious about the opportunity we're sharing here, you'll only get the full details in my report, period, nowhere else. The SPAC opportunity Harry and Jeff have put together is still not known by 90% or more of the general public.
Yeah, okay, so we've covered what a SPAC is, we've covered the deal. Now here's where you come in. In short, private investors have been making a killing for years. For example, the earliest investors in Pinterest, the social media site, saw a pre-IPO gain of 558,000%. That turns every $100 investment into more than $500,000. Meanwhile, the stock is flat since going public. And yet the general public was excluded from this pre-IPO deal because according to SEC regulations, you have to be a wealthy accredited investor to qualify. But today, we're finally sharing a backdoor.
It's a genuine backdoor anyone can use to get into private deals. And it costs as little as $10 a share, the standard price for all new SPAC deals.
And that's where the story takes an interesting turn.
Right. Earlier this year, our team took a trip to New York City to attend the world's biggest SPAC conference. It was a room full of bankers involved in pre-IPO deals. Most were looking to raise money, invest, or both. Well, during the conference, we realized we were one of the only financial journalists in the entire place. Everyone else was a banker. And when the bankers realized that, we got a lot of attention. See, the irony is bankers are desperate to find everyday Americans who want a piece of their SPAC deals. And that gave us an idea. See, I hear about hundreds of private deals a month from deal makers who never advertise.
So the minute we started hearing about all these new SPAC deals, I told Enrique, man, we've got to publish this.
Yeah, I mean, look, at this point in my career, all I want to do is help everyday folks learn how to make money. Retirees, small business owners, you name it. I launched my first hedge fund with about $500,000, grew it by more than 130,000%, and made all the money I need. Today, I'm retired from that world to spend more time with my wife and two children and a third on the way. I even turned down a seven-figure salary on Wall Street. Instead, for the first time ever, I'm doing something new.
In short, we're launching a brand new product. It's called Empire SPAC Investor. Each month, Enrique will share the best new SPAC he comes across, deals as good as the one he shared today, which he'll hear about through his network. He'll show you how to claim the pre-IPO stakes in the hottest new companies. For example, one of his contacts is a Wall Street veteran who runs a major SPAC investment banking team. He's so powerful, I can't even tell you his name here in public.
In short, I use everything I've learned after 20 years as a money manager managing more than $1 billion to filter out the garbage and only share the absolute best SPAC deals in America. I only recommend deals which, if our roles were reversed, I'd personally invest in myself. Like the time a friend told me about Felix Gray. It's a private company that makes UV protective eyeglasses. I'm sitting on a 3 or 4 bagger so far. I'll be sharing the deals I find exclusively with charter members of my new research service, Empire SPAC Investor. There's a lot of money to be made in this growing market, but you need to get in on the ground floor. You need to talk directly to the people involved. You can't just read about this stuff on a website. As Barron's recently wrote, new SPAC issuance is soaring, with multiple initial public offerings a week for several weeks running. Finding the best of these opportunities is what I'll be doing through hundreds of hours of research, travel, and phone calls every single month.
And the potential here is just astronomical compared to ordinary stock investing, right? I mean, you could...
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, just consider Graff Industrial, a SPAC that nearly doubled in 1 month this summer. Or consider Bluebird, an automaker that went public through a SPAC. You could have more than doubled your money there. Or consider Clarivate Analytics. It's an information services company that went public in 2018 through a SPAC. There you could have tripled your money. Or consider Immunovant, a SPAC from 2019. Again, you could have tripled your money. Or look at Repay Holdings, another SPAC from 2019. Again, you could have more than doubled your money. Jared, I could keep going and going.
Yeah, I know you can. And that brings me to a special bonus that we're sharing today. In short, the reason that I flew 2,000 miles to the desert of Arizona to meet with Enrique today is because, as I said before, he's considered your gatekeeper to the SPAC industry. He has direct access to almost all of the biggest players in the SPAC world. He knows how to get you in the room on all of the best new deals and pinpoint the best opportunities. And that's why in our brand new product, Empire SPAC Investor, we're creating a special feature I think you're gonna love. It's called the SPAC Deal Room. Enrique, can you talk about that?
Sure, here's how it works. I said before that my biggest secret is the great network I built across decades, all the people I know and can access. So recently I created a virtual deal room. It consists of in-depth, behind-the-scenes interviews with the best SPAC deal makers in America. All of these folks are multimillionaires and billionaires who are often considered legends in the finance world. People like Harry Sloan, Jeff Sagansky, Jim Ross, Mark Gerhard, and Bill Ackman. When you join Empire SPAC Investor, you'll get instant access to this deal room with all the interviews I've pulled from these experts. You'll also get unique insights on SPACs you simply won't see anywhere else because it only exists amongst the most connected investors who speak directly to me and my readers.
And throughout the year, you'll be adding to this deal room by meeting with other deal makers and sharing all the best and most exclusive content you come across, right? Interviews, on-the-ground videos.
Right. In addition to our regular monthly briefings, I'll constantly add exclusive content to the deal room.
And by the way, when Enrique says he's connected, it's no joke. He was the first hire at Empire Financial Research, one of the fastest growing, most exciting new investment research firms in the world. It was launched last year by Whitney Tilson, one of the best known analysts in U.S. finance, who's been called the prophet by CNBC for the accuracy of his predictions. Like the time he called the collapse of Bitcoin and Tilray, the market bottom in March of 2020, bought Apple at $1.42, Amazon at $48, McDonald's at $13, among dozens of other calls that did actually land him on 60 Minutes twice. One of Whitney's closest friends is hedge fund manager Bill Ackman, who recently made $2 billion trading the coronavirus crash. And yet when looking to build his new firm, the first person Whitney reached out to was Enrique. Take a look.
Enrique is a veteran of 25 years or so on Wall Street, and for almost the entire period, he's been studying and investing in SPACs. So he's a veteran with deep industry knowledge, and in particular, you got to know who the sponsors are, who's behind the SPACs to gauge whether they're likely to find a great company to invest in and be able to strike a great deal that benefits the SPAC shareholders. And Enrique's got the experience and, very importantly, the relationships to do that well and get in before the deals are announced and the stocks really pop. And there's nobody better than Enrique to figure out, separate the wheat from the chaff and pick the right sponsors and the right SPACs to get into.
And that's why we're pleased to announce the official charter opening today of Enrique's brand new SPAC research service, Empire SPAC Investor, the only product of its kind. Each share could cost as little as $10. And again, you can reject the deal before it goes through and walk away with most of your money. You can collect interest while waiting for a huge potential payoff, and even after the deal goes through, you can buy or sell anytime in your regular brokerage account.
In fact, one more thing, sometimes these shares cost less than $10, depending on the market. If things are unstable from the coronavirus, for example, they may cost $8 or $9 instead. But here's the best part. If you reject the deal and walk away, you can often sell your shares at potentially the full standard $10 value.
How often does that happen?
It happens. For instance, during the height of the coronavirus pandemic in early 2020, many SPACs traded at discounts to their cash held in trust, as much as 2%. That means you could essentially buy a dollar's worth of U.S. Treasury securities, where the SPACs typically hold their cash, for 98 cents. And get all the huge upside of the deal itself virtually for free.
So a crisis can get you an even better deal sometimes.
Exactly. One story I love to tell is the story about the 2008 financial crisis. My partner Whitney launched a SPAC fund called the T2 SPAC Fund in October of that year. At the time, he was running a $100 million hedge fund. He saw dozens of SPACs trading for less than $10, so he and his business partner created a side fund, raised about $5 million, invested in a basket of SPACs, and more than doubled their investors' money in less than a year.
That's amazing. Well, folks, there you have it. This is by far the easiest way we know to access private deals for the biggest and fastest potential gains in the world right now. Just keep in mind, Empire SPAC Investor isn't cheap. Enrique turned down a $1 million salary to launch this new product. Over 20 years, he ran three different hedge funds, two of which he founded, and made money in every bull market and major downturn along the way, including the blow-up of Long-Term Capital Management, the dot-com melt-up and subsequent meltdown, the 2008 crisis, and the decade-long bull market that ended earlier this year with the coronavirus. 6 months before 9/11, he launched his first fund with money raised from family and friends and grew it to $2.5 billion. He went from being an ordinary banker at Lehman Brothers to one of Wall Street's most demanded analysts through a variety of uncannily accurate calls, like his prediction to bet against Anheuser-Busch before the stock fell 40%, or Kraft before the stock fell 47%, and GE before it plummeted 73%, or his gains of 240% in 23 months on Solutia, 229% in 22 months on TRW Automotive, 167% in 21 months on Dana Incorporated, and more. Until recently, the only way to access Enrique's investment ideas was by joining his hedge fund, where you'd have paid 2 and 20. It's 2% of your assets and 20% of your profits, which amounted to a fortune. So we're charging a higher than normal price. One full year of Empire SPAC Investor will normally cost $5,000. And frankly, it's a bargain at that rate. For example, you could have made 21 times your money in under 3 months on the Nicholas SPAC we mentioned, launched by Enrique's friend Steve, a former executive at General Motors. But we realize what a difficult year this has been for most people. After the biggest market crash since 2008, and a stock market many are now considering a bubble, we think SPACs are a much, much better place to put your money right now than ordinary stocks. That's why today we're willing to make you a special offer. In short, if you get in today before charter enrollment ends, we'll knock $2,500 off the price. It's a 50% discount. You'll pay just $2,500 for one full year, but it gets even better. You see, Enrique has never forgotten his roots. After growing up poor in Phoenix, where his family often lived in trailer parks and motels, he skipped the usual MBA route and went straight to Wall Street in the early 1990s to work in private equity, determined to make his fortune. As he later put it, "I was tired of being poor." After making his first couple of $1 million, he came home, wrote his mother a check for $500,000, and told her she'd never have to work again. Today, he's determined to help ordinary Americans enjoy the same kind of freedom. And if there's one thing Enrique hates, it's seeing someone promise financial freedom in a message like this and then fail to deliver. That's why through this special charter offer, we're willing to make you a powerful new guarantee. Enrique?
Look, we've talked about big gains today and we want to deliver. So here's my guarantee. If you don't see the chance to at least triple your money in our model portfolio over the next 12 months, then you'll receive a second year of access to Empire SPAC Investor free of charge. Even if you see 199% gain, doesn't matter. You'll still get comped a full $5,000 subscription for a second year. It's the only way I'll do business.
Yeah, that's awesome, Enrique. And certainly sounds more than fair to me. And I'm sure you're going to be posting gains a lot bigger than a triple based on your track record. Now, as a new member of Empire SPAC Investor, you'll receive Enrique's model portfolio in the next few minutes. It includes the full details on how to buy into Harry Sloan's new SPAC private deal immediately. Again, don't try to guess the ticker symbol on your own, or you could risk buying the wrong investment and losing money. Plus, you'll hear about two more SPAC deals we urge you to consider right now, which I think you're going to love. The fact is, private equity deals have a decades-long proven history of delivering multiple times higher gains than ordinary stocks, if you're lucky enough to hear about them and get in. Like Robinhood, up 6,297%, SoundHound up 2,132%, BuzzFeed up almost 8,000%, among hundreds more. Each month for the next year, Enrique will email you a full briefing on his newest SPAC recommendation and the best and most interesting opportunities he sees in the SPAC universe. Each will have the potential to double or triple your money over the short run and make you 10 times your money or more over the long run. You'll receive all the info you need to quickly and easily buy into the deal for as little as $10 per share, and even less in some cases, including how to receive your warrants, which could help you make an extra 100% gain or more on each deal.
And Jared, one more thing I want to add. If you take advantage of this offer today, before this offer expires, you'll also receive a free copy of my new masterclass. It's a series of online trading videos where I'll walk you, in detail, step by step, through the full process of SPAC investing, including how these deals take shape, where to find the best deals, how to collect your interest payments, and when to buy and sell for the biggest gains. Think of it as a crash course for anyone who wants to go really deep on this topic.
Yeah, and that's amazing. I think you could probably charge as much as $5,000 alone just to access your masterclass. But you're giving this away free today to all new charter subscribers.
Correct. But you must get in today before this offer expires.
Remember, Enrique will get you access to deals with some of the best dealmakers in America to help you see the highest gains possible. Experts like Mario Gabelli, a money manager who's been profiled on the Forbes list of billionaires, to name just one example. In the next few minutes, you'll receive your password to the Empire SPAC Investor website, where you'll have full access to Enrique's new research report, SPACs, How to Make 5 to 10 Times Your Money with the Best Private Deals, including his exclusive behind-the-scenes interview with Harry Sloan and Jeff Sagansky, the multimillionaire businessmen who created the SPAC deal we're sharing today. Plus, you'll receive access to the SPAC Deal Room, which currently consists of these tell-all interviews with the most powerful SPAC experts in America. Enrique will be in touch with you throughout the month to share any important updates, like when to add to each position and when to sell. Just remember, we're opening access for the first time ever, and we're closing this charter offer soon. So if you're interested, we urge you to get in today before it's too late. You'll save $2,500 off the price, lock in the performance guarantee, and get a free copy of Enrique's masterclass. I think you'll find it's more than worth it. As one of Enrique's earliest readers, Leal W. says, I have made 100% win rate so far on Enrique's recommendations. Having said that, we offer 100% customer satisfaction guarantee. Take the next 30 days to look over Empire SPAC Investor. We think you'll make a fortune on the SPAC deals you'll hear about, but if you're not happy for any reason, no problem. Simply contact our member services team and you'll receive a full credit refund of everything you pay today. And you can apply that credit towards any other product published by Empire Financial Research. For example, we also publish Whitney Tilson's flagship research letter, The Empire Investment Report. Whitney taps his network of hedge fund managers, including David Einhorn and Leon Cooperman and Bill Ackman, all of whom are subscribers, and shows you which stocks could double or triple your money. Five different billionaires have already subscribed. Or you can get credit for any of Enrique's other research services. Empire Elite Trader is a weekly trading product with a phenomenal track record. And Empire Elite Growth, a longer-term growth stock product that aims for 500 to 1,000% gains with each pick, both of which have drawn massive acclaim. As reader Andrew E. says, I can easily say that I've cleared $5,000 from taking small positions with Enrique's recommendations. So if you enjoy our research, you're fully protected. The bottom line is this: you can either keep buying ordinary stocks, or you could try SPACs, completely new way of investing, for the chance to make multiple times more money. To secure your spot, click below. Just don't forget, if you order right now, before this charter offer expires, you'll receive 50% off the standard price, and you'll be protected by one of the best guarantees we've ever made. See the chance to triple your money in our model portfolio over the next 12 months, or you'll get a second year valued at $5,000 absolutely free of charge. Plus, order today, and you'll get a free copy of the SPAC Masterclass. Enrique, is there anything else that you want to add?
Yeah, I'd like to say something personal. The first tattoo I ever got is this. It says One Life. You've got to enjoy every moment of your life because pretty soon you'll be gone. Do you really want to spend your time chasing a salary? This has never been more clear to me. Recently, right after I left Wall Street, my mother passed away. Months later, I lost my father. You've got to enjoy your life now. Maximize every moment of your life now. For me as an investor, that means never ever invest in something unless you realistically could make up to 1,000%. Make every dollar count. That's what I'll strive to do each month in this product.
Yeah, well said. Thank you for that. Click below to claim your charter membership. And by the way, if you want even more information or you're still on the fence, we're going to hold a special Q&A session right now featuring special guests Whitney Tilson and Bill Ackman, who made $2 billion trading the coronavirus crash and is now launching the largest SPAC ever. We'll cover all of the most frequently asked questions, including which sectors offer the most exciting SPACs right now, how many warrants do you typically receive in these deals, and what has their performance been like, and finally, which companies will go SPAC next. There are rumors that Airbnb, Robinhood, and more could soon go public through a SPAC. We'll talk about that. Again, we urge you to place your order now before this offer expires to secure your charter membership to Empire SPAC Investor at 50% off the normal price, a free copy of the SPAC's Masterclass, and our performance guarantee. And with that, let's kick off the Q&A. Okay, first question, Enrique. The new SPAC deal you're sharing today was put together by Harry Sloan and Jeff Sagansky. A lot of people don't know who Jeff is, but he's literally a legend out of the business world, right? Can you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. If you don't know the name Jeff Sagansky, he's a veteran of NBC and CBS, where he developed hits like The Cosby Show and Cheers. Jeff Spak recently helped take the betting application DraftKings public, a pre-IPO style deal that would have quadrupled your money in just 6 months if you had gotten in.
So he's exactly the kind of guy you want to partner with on a SPAC deal.
You bet he is. He's a Harvard Business School MBA, who is a CBS executive and Sony Entertainment co-president. He'll play a key role in Harry's new SPAC deal. This is likely the only time you'll ever get a chance to invest alongside him.
Were you one of the first people to hear about Jeff's new SPAC deal, the one that we're sharing today,
I was. And by the way, one cool thing I want to mention about the DraftKings deal, the last SPAC deal he and Harry put together. For a long time, Jeff and Harry's SPAC was just a pool of cash, and people had no idea what they planned to acquire. Then around Christmas of last year, word started leaking out in the press that they were targeting DraftKings. The company still wasn't public yet, but on just the excitement alone, shares of their SPAC immediately took off. You couldn't buy them for $10 a share anymore. By April, when the deal finally went through, you'd have just about doubled your money. And then, after April 24th, when DraftKings officially went public, the stock went nuts. By early June, shares were up more than 300%.
So, lesson here is act quickly.
Exactly, because by the time word starts to leak out about Harry and Jeff's new SPAC, largely through videos like this one, the shares could take off. And that's before the target company even goes public.
And you have a long history of making incredible private investments, including that $25,000 stake in the apparel company. How did you pull that off exactly?
Well, it's a really funny story. At my last hedge fund, there was one of the accounting guys, and he came to me one day and said, "Hey, I've got a friend who started an apparel company. Are you interested in investing?" And as I mentioned before, I was a bit skeptical. I don't really see apparel as a huge growth industry. And so originally I told him no. Then he came back 6 months later and he said, "My buddy's apparel company is doing fantastic." I said to him, "Well, what does fantastic mean?" He says, "Look, sales have gone from $500,000 to $5 million in almost 6 months." That seemed pretty interesting to me at that point. So I met the CEO there and was really blown away by him and his knowledge of direct marketing and the industry that he was in. And I made that investment, and I've made, you know, as we've mentioned, more than 10 times my money. And in fact, I think they're getting ready to do another deal that could make us much, much more than even that. So it's really about having people that you know and then being able to do the analysis properly.
All right, so moving on to another question. What sectors offer the most exciting SPACs right now?
Well, I think a lot of the SPAC industry is focused on growth sectors that are the most exciting growth sectors overall for the economy. Two that I would highlight, which we've spoken about before, are electric vehicles and autonomous vehicles. We believe that electric vehicles will be much more common than anyone else thinks, much sooner than anyone else thinks. If that happens, imagine the growth when we go from 1 or 2% of all cars on this planet to 80 or 90% being electric vehicles. Another great area is the video game space. You know, video games have been around for a very long time. You might have played Atari 2600 like me. But with the coronavirus, you've actually seen another stair-step function or an acceleration in growth, because as people had more time where they weren't going to bars or restaurants or sporting events, they were home more and they played more video games. You know, right now there's probably 1 billion to 2 billion people playing video games of some type, and we think that number could double again. So those are the kinds of exciting growth areas where a lot of the SPAC sponsors are focused and where we're focused and we have broad and deep knowledge.
Yep. All right. Well, thank you for that. Now, Enrique, this might be a good time to ask you a personal question. You're not exactly a typical Wall Street analyst. I mean, you know, you're obviously covered in tattoos. You're a diehard heavy metal fan. You're friends with members of some of the biggest bands in the world. You've been to hundreds of their shows. How did a guy like you end up in finance?
Well, I mean, we talked about it earlier. I actually grew up right down the road here, about 10 miles away, not quite in as big a house. In fact, apartment complexes and trailers. You know, my mother was an immigrant from South America. My father wasn't around very much, or when he was problematic. So she did a really great job working to support me, but we grew up pretty poor. I mean, through high school, we started to do better, but I made a conscious choice. I didn't like being poor, and so I applied and got into the best undergraduate business program in the world, the Wharton School of Business, and then set my mind for the next 20 years to making money for, you know, my mother's future, my future, et cetera. And it was only afterwards then that I, after I made some of that money, that I really began to do some other things that I was interested in, like the tattoo world and the heavy metal world.
And now you're an entrepreneur yourself as well, right? I mean, a couple of years ago, I believe you launched an entire digital media e-commerce company.
Yeah, no, I own a company called Project M Group, where I was a co-founder. That company owns the number one brand in heavy metal media, Revolver Magazine. It also owns the number one brand in tattoo media, Inked Magazine. It's about a $10 million platform growing 100% a year. It's been a really, really exciting ride. And again, I think it speaks to our ability to focus on finding some of the best growth investments out there.
Yeah, but it's an amazing personal story. All right, folks, with that, I want to bring in Whitney Tilson, former $200 million hedge fund manager and founder of Empire Financial. Whitney, can you hear us?
Yes, I can.
Okay, Whitney, first off, you launched a SPAC fund in 2008 with enormous success.
Yeah, that's right. It was a little side fund because back in the global financial crisis, SPACs got clobbered, and both the SPAC stocks as well as the warrants were trading way down. But it was the kind of thing we didn't want to put too much of our main fund's capital in it. So we set up a side fund over the course of just a couple of weeks because we thought the opportunity was fleeting. And we more than doubled our investors' money in just over a year.
Tell us about that experience. I mean, what kind of companies did you target and how was your performance?
Yeah, there was at that time, the universe of SPACs was about 75, if I recall, and they were being priced as if none of them were going to get any deals done during the global financial crisis. And in fact, a lot of them didn't get deals done. We didn't just go out and broadly buy a basket of dozens of these. My partner at the time, Glenn Tung, and I knew a lot of the sponsors, and we bet on six or eight of them, if I recall correctly, that had the best sponsors, and there were other elements of how they were structured and so forth. A lot of people were buying the shares and were going to vote against any deal because they would just get cash back. And if you could buy the shares at $8 and get $10 a share back in cash, there were people out there playing that arbitrage. But the problem is that meant the warrants, which are only have value if a deal gets done, would therefore be worthless. So we had to not only find good sponsors, but also the correct structures where shareholders couldn't block deals from getting done. And at that point, you know, you could buy the warrants for as low as 20 cents sometimes. And if a deal got done, they were worth $2. You could make 10 times your money on the warrants, which was far more attractive to us than just buying the stock at $8 and getting $10 if a deal didn't get done. So that's the way we played it. We had a number of those hit and made a lot of money. I think collectively, you know, we invested in a mix of stock, bigger positions in the stock, which was completely safe because it was backstopped by cash. And then we had smaller positions in the warrants, but a couple of those hit. And so, you know, on a combined basis, we more than doubled our investors' money in just over a year.
Now, Whitney, have you personally invested in any SPACs?
No, I haven't for really a very simple reason. I never invested outside of my hedge funds. When I was running hedge funds for almost 18 years, I had a very simple policy to prevent any conflicts of interest that I only did my investing through my hedge funds, had no personal account, and therefore all of the investing back in when there was a great opportunity in the SPAC market back in 2008, I just did it first through my existing hedge funds, and then we created that special side fund that I discussed earlier solely to invest in SPACs. Then the opportunity sort of disappeared in the wake of the global financial crisis. There were almost no new SPACs launched, and so there really wasn't an opportunity to invest in SPACs. And now that I'm with Empire Financial Research, we're launching a SPAC newsletter. We have a policy here of never investing in anything that we might recommend to our readers, again, so that our readers never question whether we have any conflicts of interest. And so I think there's some very interesting SPACs out there. But instead of going out and buying them in my personal account, we decided to create a SPAC-focused newsletter. And since I'm not exactly sure which SPACs, Enrique, who's running that newsletter primarily, it's going to be a team effort, but he's the lead. Not sure which SPACs he's going to recommend. And so the safest thing to do is just not own SPACs in my personal account. But if we didn't have a SPAC newsletter, I'd definitely be putting a good chunk of my personal account in that sector.
The rise of COVID-19 has led to a resurgence in SPACs. How long do you see this trend continuing? Would a COVID-19 vaccine return to normal sort of thing, would that kill the SPAC market? Or do you think SPACs are here to stay? What's your opinion on that?
Yeah, I think SPACs were booming before COVID-19 came along. I think the fact that SPACs have a big pile of cash in a world now in which some companies have unlimited access to cash, you know, Amazon and Apple and Microsoft and so forth. But there are a lot of companies out there whose businesses have really been hammered by COVID that need cash. And these would be private companies, of course, that would be looking to go public by merging with a SPAC. Well, one of the big advantages of a SPAC is they've already raised a big pile of cash. So COVID has definitely been a tailwind for the SPAC business. But I'm actually fairly optimistic. Not so much about vaccines. I tend to believe what the experts say is probably a widespread vaccine won't be available till the middle of next year. But actually, I actually think the United States, just because so many people have gotten COVID already, the most vulnerable people in particular, I'm here in New York City, and the numbers here, we got hit the hardest, but in part because so many people got the virus, we're not seeing any kind of a second wave here at all. And I'm optimistic, actually, that the United States is not going to see a big second wave that many people are predicting or fearing later this year. So, and the stock market, by the way, is largely pricing that in. The indices are basically at all-time highs these days, or very close to it. And nevertheless, the SPAC market is booming. And so I think part of it is SPACs over their 20, 30-year history were a small little niche sector. And honestly, there was almost like a taint to it. The sponsors were not super well-respected, incredible people. The companies they took public were companies that couldn't IPO because they were lousy companies. And so there was some boom and bust element to the SPAC market, and people looked down on it. That in the past couple of years has really changed. And some of the absolute blue chip people with the very best reputations, investment firms and buyout firms, but also hedge funds like Bill Ackman of Pershing Square, have gotten into the SPAC market. And that in turn has made real companies that could IPO the traditional route. They want to partner up with people like Bill Ackman and have them on their boards and have them as long-term investors rather than the short-term investors who just flip their stocks on a traditional IPO. So, just the other day, Snowflake went public. And one of the big problems with the traditional IPO process is they leave a ton of money on the table. Snowflake doubled on its IPO, is up 112%. Well, that's why wasn't the stock priced at a higher price and the company could have raised twice as much money. And instead, all that excess money went to the investment banker's favored clients who got in at the IPO price and made a quick flip. Well, that's great for the investment banks who are already charging high fees as well, but it's lousy for the companies. So companies, I think, are quite rightly, for a variety of reasons, seeing SPACs now as, in many cases, a better way to go public. They get immediate cash. They get blue chip sponsors as long-term investors, joining their board of directors as large permanent shareholders. And there's better price discovery. They don't leave a ton of money on the table like Snowflake did just recently.
Recent years have seen extremely disappointing IPOs. Are SPACs a reaction to that? Are SPACs the new IPO? What's your take?
Well, look, there are three ways that companies can go public. Historically, virtually all companies went through door A, the traditional IPO process with a roadshow, high fees to the bankers, lack of price discovery. So often, you know, they're looking for a big pop on the IPO, but in fact, that's just money left on the table that didn't go to companies, right? So that's actually not a good thing generally for the companies, but that was the only route. There are two new ways that are developing now. One is a direct listing, where companies just put their stock out there. So they're not raising capital. They're just starting their privately traded shares are out there publicly. And there's actually been a rule against companies being allowed to issue new stock and therefore raise capital through a direct listing. But that has that rule may get changed. And so direct listings may become more common. But companies like Google went public via direct listing. And then lastly, you have SPACs, which it's a booming sector. I think the SPACs have raised more money this year than, you know, the past many years combined, and the year's certainly not even over. So SPACs provide a lot of advantages. You don't have to do a big roadshow. You just negotiate a deal with the SPAC sponsors, and if you reach a deal, you basically go public because the SPAC is already public. So by merging with the SPAC, your shares then instantly become public and traded. You get a big slug of cash. You get, in most sponsors, the sponsors are getting better and better over time. So you're getting very high quality people joining your board of directors, becoming long-term shareholders. So SPACs, now that the industry has become, has attracted more capital and more high quality sponsors, that means more high quality companies are willing to go public by merging with a SPAC. And so there's a virtuous cycle going on here that I think is here to stay.
To successfully invest in SPACs, how important is it to know the best deal makers? What's your opinion? Can you speak to this as well from personal experience? I know you're a big networker.
Yeah. So both Enrique and I, who are going to be publishing our SPAC newsletter, Enrique is going to be the lead on it, have spent more than two decades on Wall Street. And we know many of the sponsors that are doing SPACs. And if we don't know them personally, I'm college buddies and have been very close friends with Bill Ackman of Pershing Square that just launched the largest SPAC ever, Pershing Square Tontine Holdings. So we have personal relationships like that. And where we don't have the personal relationships, we're one degree of separation from getting access to anybody, as well as also just knowing people's reputation and so forth. So we have a lot of experience in relationships that we think will give us an edge in evaluating SPACs. And then on top of that, just decades of experience that Enrique and I have, investing in SPACs, knowing the space. Both of us have done private investing personally and in our funds in the past. So SPAC investing is an interesting mix of, knowing who the sponsors are, but then also being able, once they announce a deal, being able to figure out which deals make sense, were they done at a good price. So it helps to have general experience in the SPAC sector, but also experience doing private market investing, doing buyouts, that kind of thing. Enrique and I really bring a lot of those skill sets to the table in a way that makes us think that our newsletter, that we can really deliver a lot of value to our subscribers by sharing all of the accumulated experience and relationships, applying that to our analysis so that we can make the very best recommendations for our subscribers and make them a lot of money.
You know, Whitney, I know that when you started Empire Financial, Enrique was the first guy you thought about. How positioned is he to help readers take advantage of the SPAC market? And what advantages do you think that he's going to bring to SPAC investment research?
Yeah, well, Enrique's got 20 plus years of experience in the SPAC sector specifically, but just generally, it's a broader skill set that you need to bring to the table. That's relationships, that's experience. In SPACs specifically, but just in the buyout world. Enrique has just been an incredible entrepreneur in the investment management space. He's raised venture capital for small companies and done deals there, but also been involved in bigger deals as well. So just brings a tremendously broad skill set and sort of an outside the box mindset and way of thinking. I can't think of anyone better to spearhead this new initiative around SPACs for this newsletter. I've got quite a bit of experience myself, so it's going to be a team effort. Our third sort of guru at Empire, Berna Barshe, brings a 20 years of experience herself across the investing world. And so, you know, it's a team effort led by Enrique, you know, well over 60 years of experience combined of Wall Street experience that I think really aligns well with what's necessary to understand what's going on in the SPAC world, to stay away from, you know, in a hot sector, there are always lots of bad deals and almost like scams going on, to stay away from that and to know, you know, what's legit, what companies are legit, what SPACs are structured well, that have the right sponsors, that are going to be a very good risk reward investment, and be able to every month share that with our subscribers and help them make a lot of money.
Okay, finally, Whitney, our most exciting question. Obviously, we've talked about this. You're very close friends with Bill Ackman, who just launched the largest SPAC ever. Have you and Bill spoken about this at all? Do you have any hint as to what Bill is targeting or what he hopes to accomplish by launching this SPAC?
Right, absolutely. Well, I can do you one better. We not only spoke privately about this, but he agreed to go on camera, and we had more than a half an hour conversation just the other day. And I asked him precisely those questions. We sat down and I asked him to just give an overview of the SPAC industry. We talked about whether it's here to stay and a bunch of other questions. Then we took a deep dive into his particular SPAC, which I think is very uniquely structured and is very interesting. And then at the end, we had a little bonus conversation outside the SPAC world that you won't want to miss. Where Bill shares some in-depth details he's never shared before about the greatest investment of all time, is what people are calling it, the investment he made earlier this year in credit default swaps, right as the pandemic was hitting, where he turned $27 million into $2.6 billion. He made 100 times his money, and I hope you're sitting down, he did it in 12 days. Truly the most extraordinary investment of all time. So he also talks about that as well. So you won't want to miss it.
Okay, so can we run that Q&A with Bill? Okay, great.
Thank you for joining us, Bill. I'm sure most of our viewers know who you are, but for those who don't, let me briefly introduce you. You and I have been good friends since we went to Harvard together in the mid-1980s. After you graduated from Harvard Business School in 1992, you were one of the pioneers launching one of the first hedge funds. And since then, you've built an incredible track record. And not surprisingly, you now manage one of the largest investment management firms in the world, Pershing Square, with $11.7 billion in assets under management. So again, thanks for joining us. And can you start for our viewers, many of whom may not be familiar with even what a SPAC is, and just describe it to us?
Sure. So SPAC, or Special Purpose Acquisition Company, another term, blank check company, is as it sounds. It's a IPO for a company that raises cash and gets a listing on a well-known stock exchange like the New York Stock Exchange. And the sponsor of the SPAC's job is to find a company to merge this cash shell with. So envision a private company that wants to go public. You know, their choices are an IPO, now a direct listing, or last, actually, we would argue first, a SPAC, depending on the terms and the founder and the structure. But it's a way for a private company to raise cash and go public, you know, kind of disintermediating what is typically a six-month IPO process.
Gotcha. So the first SPACs, I actually Googled this, you know, date back to the 1990s. There have been hundreds of them over time. But this is your first SPAC, you know, decades after the industry really was created. So can you tell us a little bit about, you know, how the industry has developed and how your thinking about it has changed?
Sure. So actually, it's actually our second SPAC where we're a founder, but there are our first SPAC where there are no other partners. So the first time I really took a hard look at SPACs was when I was approached by two entrepreneurs, Nicholas Berggruen and Martin Franklin, and Martin being the former CEO of Jarden. I'm sure you know Martin, Nicholas. Nicholas Berggruen you might know as well. And they were raising money for a SPAC. And we ended up being the kind of anchor investor and becoming a co-founder of that entity. This was in the 2011 timeframe. And we had a very good experience with it, which is we identified Burger King as a potential merger candidate through a relationship with one of our, kind of longstanding relationship we've had with the folks at 3G. And we merged that entity called Justice Holdings with Burger King. And that's how Burger King became public. Now today, no one remembers that Burger King went public by merging with a SPAC. But what was interesting about it is you had some of the most sophisticated financial sponsors in the world, the folks at 3G. And they chose, rather than do an IPO, to merge with our entity called Justice Holdings. And their thought process was, an IPO would be incredibly distracting to our management team. Typical company today, they file a prospectus with the SEC. Every one of their employees gets calls from financial advisors pitching them on how they're going to invest all the money they're going to make. They get calls from real estate brokers saying, hey, you should buy this house, you should buy that house. And everyone loses focus on what they should be doing is running a company. And the beauty of a properly structured SPAC transaction is that the first announcement is an announcement that the company's going public. And it's structured correctly, and I can talk a little bit about the nature of our SPAC, you're done at that point in time. It's just a matter of logistics getting to a closing. And that is a vastly superior prospect. And because of its superiority, its efficiency, and because we're only buying a minority interest in whatever that company is, the counterparty to a transaction is open to selling a minority interest at a lower price than where they expect the company to trade once it's public. And that's the benefit that goes to, if you will, the SPAC shareholder, is that they get in at a pre-IPO private company valuation, and then all going well, when the company goes public, their starting price is much more attractive.
Yeah, that's that actually leads perfectly into sort of my next question, which is, a lot of individual investors are looking out there at these incredibly attractive private companies, and they can't invest. Individual investors obviously don't have deal flow. They don't have large pools of capital. So are SPACs the solution, sort of a backdoor way for individual investors to gain access to these companies?
They can be. And I think they offer some very attractive elements. U.S. SPACs give every investor the right to redeem their interest, i.e. get their money back, the IPO price plus a nominal amount of interest, if they don't like the target company. So it's got a money back guarantee, which is, one of the really interesting elements. The second thing is, the really hot IPOs, retail investors aren't not able to get into the IPO transaction. But if you buy a SPAC prior to it doing a merger, you're guaranteed to have an option to either invest in the company or get your money back. And it's that element of the structure that is, I think, very appealing to retail investors as well as even, as institutional investors.
Yeah. Now, before we talk about your particular SPAC and how it's different, I was wondering if you could just answer one more question about the market in general. The SPAC market has tended to be a bit of a boom and bust phenomenon. When the market's hot, when deals are a lot of deals are happening, sort of SPACs are almost like have historically a criticism of the industry has sort of been a bubble market phenomenon, right? A sure sign of a bubble is that SPACs are hot. SPACs are super hot these days. Do you think the industry has changed? Like, are you bullish on the industry long-term? Do you think it's going to become just a more accepted way of companies going public and lose some of this boom and bust phenomenon in the future?
So actually, if you follow the history of SPACs over time, there's been, sort of the SPAC 1.0, 2.0, there have been sort of different iterations. And I think one of the big changes that took place is it used to be that in order to invest your capital in the deal, the vote to invest. So basically the way it works is once a target's been identified and the merger's been announced, it then goes to a shareholder vote. In the first generation of SPACs, the shareholder vote, if the shareholder vote doesn't go forward, of course the transaction doesn't happen. But investors could only vote in favor of the deal going forward if they were investing the capital, if they'd agreed to go into the deal. And the SEC allowed a separation between the right to redeem and the right to vote in favor of a transaction. That was a very significant development. And that took place, I don't actually know the precise date, but that change made SPACs much more viable. And what I mean to say is today you can invest in a SPAC IPO, or you can buy the stock in the market. At the time a transaction is announced, you get a prospectus in the mail, you read it. If you decide for whatever reason you don't want to invest in the business and you want to redeem, that is get your money back, you can still vote in favor of the deal and get all of your cash back. Now, why would you want to do that? Well, the answer is typical SPAC transactions, in the IPO, you get common stock and you get warrants. And those warrants are only valuable if a deal happens. So what's interesting is you can vote in favor of the deal in a typical SPAC. You get your warrants, which you got as part of the IPO, and you can get all your money back. And so you have a free warrant on a deal. But that change in structure made it very likely almost every SPAC transaction, shareholders vote in favor of the transaction. And so that risk was taken off the table. What happened before that was often, you know, SPACs would trade at a discount to the IPO price, arbitrageurs would buy the shares, and then no matter how, you know, they would vote down the deal to get back their money with cash. And now with a separation of those two things, deals, the vote is highly likely to go forward. That was one sort of iteration. The next sort of 2.0 was a real improvement in the quality of sponsors, much more sophisticated sponsors who were putting up more capital and forming partnerships with institutions. So there was more committed capital to a SPAC, which meant that in the event that shareholders redeemed, there was still a minimum amount of capital that would go forward in transaction. That was sort of an important innovation. Again, I don't have the dates for any of these things. But the basic construct of founder stock has really never changed for SPACs until we launched our entity, Pershing Square Tontine Holdings, a little over a month ago, maybe 6 weeks ago. And that, I think, will, you know, we'll see what happens. It hasn't, you know, people yet haven't given up founder stock. We're the only ones to have done so. But I think the terms are going to continue to improve for investors. And that will make, I think, increase the likelihood that the SPAC is kind of here to stay. And people differentiate SPACs like they do investment firms, you know, based on the quality of the sponsors and the terms for investors. And as those terms are improved by competition, it will just get better for investors.
Right. Now, you raised $4 billion of external capital. You've committed a minimum of $1 billion more of capital from the various Pershing Square funds. So you've got a minimum of $5 billion, making it the biggest SPAC ever. And in fact, I read with interest that there have only been three IPOs of any sort, forget just SPACs, in the U.S. market in the past decade, which are Alibaba, Uber, and Facebook, that are exceed that size. So this was, and what's crazy is from reading your latest investor letter to Pershing Square Holdings is you shut down your roadshow for the IPO after only one day when there was 12 billion of interest and you only took four. So that raises two questions. One, it's very rare to hear any investment manager turn down $8 billion. So why'd you do that and limit it to only $4 billion would be the first question. And then the second is why was there so much demand? What was it? You touched briefly earlier on this concept of not taking founder stock, but there, you did a lot of things to make it a much more investor-friendly vehicle than your typical SPAC. So can you talk about those two things?
Sure. So I think, one, the reason why we capped it at $4 billion was, one, we're investing a minimum of $1 billion. We have the right to invest up to $3 billion. And we actually want to invest the money. So unlike pretty much every other SPAC is raised by a entrepreneur who's in the SPAC business, right? And they view this, or they're a fund sponsor, and this is a way for them to raise extra capital. We're not actually increasing the amount of capital at Pershing Square that we can earn a promote on by raising this entity. So our incentives are very different from other sponsors. The $1 billion we're putting up are coming from existing assets. So all that Pershing Square Tontine Holdings does for us is create the opportunity for Pershing Square to make a large investment in a private company that we take public. And we think that's a really attractive opportunity. So one, we approach this from the perspective of an investor as opposed to from the perspective of a promoter. If we were raising capital on which we'd earn a promote or get founder stock, our incentive is to raise as much as possible. And I don't think there's ever been a SPAC that's capped the amount of money they take. They've generally take what they can raise. What we've done here is what we want to own is a minority interest in a large company. So with $4 billion in the IPO, $1 billion from us, to own a minority interest, a less than 50% interest in the company has to have north of a $10 billion market cap. And the bigger the IPO, the bigger the company we'd have to buy. And our concern was if we got too big, we're actually starting to shrink the universe of mega cap companies that we could merge with. And there are a lot of interesting ones between 10 and 15 billion. And if we raised a couple billion more, we'd have seven. Our minimum would be 14. So again, it was really driven by making sure we didn't shrink the investable universe. So we wanted to be large enough that we were completely differentiated from every other SPAC. So we're not competing with other SPACs to do a big deal, but not so large that we would push away, potential opportunities. And our focus on a minority interest is so that we wouldn't be competing with private equity and strategics, right? If you're buying a controlling interest in a company, there are a very large number of investors and the seller will want the highest price, right? If you're selling 100% of your company, you want the last dollar. If you're selling 20% of your company in a merger, which enables you to take your company public, but you keep control, you're much less price sensitive. And that was the thinking behind why we capped the size of the deal.
Right. And by the way, just to make this, it may not be obvious to all of our viewers, but this now trades publicly, like anyone who wants to buy this into your SPAC can do so right now. So
I just got off the phone earlier, got off Zoom, if you will, just before this call with you, Whitney, with one of the most well-known private equity firms in the country. The CEO of that firm, and they love the structure, and they're kind of looking through their portfolio to see if there's a company that's a counterparty. So we are confident that we're going to find a very interesting company on attractive terms. I do think that is likely.
Yeah. The last question about SPACs and your SPAC is there was a report in the press that you had a conversation with Airbnb, which according to the press report decided to go the traditional IPO route. But, is that, I don't know whether you can confirm or deny that conversation, but is that the kind of company, the size, more a tech-oriented company, et cetera? Can you give us any hints about, what kind of company you're targeting?
So we're looking really kind of three broad categories of companies, what we're calling mature unicorns, of which there are very few. These are sort of venture-backed, high-growth, high return on capital, great companies with mature, experienced management teams that either cash flow positive or on a very clear path to being a cash flow positive business. And there are not many of those. And even today, I don't know if Airbnb is one of those, right? I've had the opportunity to Zoom with management. I've not seen the prospectus for the IPO. I don't have inside information. I'm attracted to the business, but I don't know enough about how well the company's run. It has to be both a great company and it needs to be run well. And by the way, some of those, the title of the initial press report was Airbnb rebuffs us. They really didn't rebuff us at all. I think their first choice is to go public the conventional route, and some companies are going to choose to do that. They filed a prospectus sometime toward the end of August, and it will probably become a public document. We're going to have an opportunity to learn more about the business. But there are many other companies that we're talking to where those discussions have not been publicly disclosed, where we have lots of potential transactions that are interesting. So it's either mature unicorn, that's probably the smallest category of companies because there are not many. Others include private equity sponsored companies, of which there's a very large universe. And the third category are kind of family controlled businesses. And then there are sort of another, employee owned companies, another sort of mix of businesses. And that's really the focus. But the key for us is business quality. We're looking for a super durable, high quality growth company with an excellent management team.
Right. Now, all of your public stock holdings, from Starbucks to Lowe's to Agilent to restaurant brands, et cetera, it's a wide range of industries, but they would all sort of fit that general description, right? Super high quality companies, wide moats. Long-term growers, good management is basically you're looking to apply the same criteria.
Absolutely. So we have nine investments today in Pershing Square. And then we have Pershing Square Tontine Holdings that will create the 10th investment. And we really created this entity to create an investment opportunity for us. And the public gets to invest along with us as our partner.
All right. Thank you for taking the time to join us and to educate our viewers here about SPACs and about your SPAC, Pershing Square Tontine Holdings. It's been fascinating.
Okay. Thank you so much. All right, Woody. Have a great day.
Okay, back to you, Enrique. I have to ask you, as someone who's outside the norm of a typical financial analyst, are you attracted to SPACs for how different they are? I mean, you're obviously not the type that follows a crowd.
Yeah, well, look, clearly I've chosen to live my personal life differently than most people. I do what makes me happy and I invest accordingly. Financially, that means I'm not willing to accept the typical garbage that passes for an investment idea. I'm not satisfied buying some stupid ETF and making 5% a year. If I'm going to invest and do the work, I want to make 5 times my money, 10 times my money. Plus, I love meeting people. I love getting out in the world and talking to CEOs and checking out their headquarters. And in my experience, these two things come together best in the private market. Instead of recommending a blue chip stock like any other newsletter writer, I can essentially get you into a room with hard-hitting legends like Harry Sloan and Jeff Sagansky, and into a private deal the public won't hear about until long after the biggest gains have been made.
Do you think SPACs are the future of investing?
The reality is, most IPOs happen just to make the company founders rich. Management couldn't care less about the shareholders. So if you want to make real money, you've got to do what I did back when I was a poor kid looking to change my life. You got to play the game at its source. Unless you're founding the company yourself, you better damn well find a way to invest alongside the founder. Don't settle for the leftovers. That's what private investing is all about, in my opinion. And it's why SPACs might be one of the greatest backdoor investments in the history of Wall Street.
Yeah, not to mention the ongoing decline of traditional IPOs.
Yeah, again, nearly half of all the money being raised for IPOs this year is going towards SPACs, a record high. It seems like almost every week there's a new SPAC story in the mainstream press. That should tell you something. Even Bloomberg has said that SPACs could knock traditional IPOs off the pedestal. So get in now while it's still a secret and not well known, before everybody and their brother starts talking about SPACs.
So let's talk about warrants. They're sort of like a lottery ticket you receive with your SPAC investment. How many warrants do you typically receive in these deals, and what has their performance been like?
Each SPAC is different. With some, you get one warrant for every share you buy. With others, you might get one warrant for every 3 shares you buy. But the bottom line is, you want the warrants, not just the stock, because warrants magnify the gain you can make on the regular shares by multiple amounts, often a lot faster. For example, look at the warrants for Nikola. You could have made 5 times your money in just 3 days. Or take another look at DraftKings. If you know my friends Harry Sloan and Jeff Sagansky, you could have bought $10 stock shares as far back as July 2019 and quadrupled your money in just 6 months, which is pretty nice, sure, but you also could have received warrants. And here's the thing about warrants. They don't become active until the deal is announced and the company officially goes public. But once they do, it's like getting a free call option on the stock, an extra boost of potentially hundreds of percent. In this case, the warrants didn't activate until April 24th, 2020, the day that DraftKings officially went public. You could have made 22 times your money on the warrants less than 2 months after that.
And of course, warrants aren't exclusive to SPACs.
No, of course not. For example, look at gold miner New Gold. The stock more than doubled in the recent gold bull market, but the warrants did even better. They more than tripled in the same time span. The only difference is normally you have to pay for a warrant, but with SPACs, you can get them free in some cases if you get in early.
Well, clearly, warrants can be a fantastic way to supersize your gains. But one question, why not just buy an option on the company?
Well, one of the nice things is that the warrants, again, you get them for free when you buy the stock in the company. And sometimes the warrants also don't expire for a very long time. Most of the time when you're buying options, they're usually rather short dated. And so you're constantly battling father time in terms of realizing the value on the option.
Enrique, one of the best parts of all of this are what I call the secret stock tickers. Each SPAC has its own stock ticker. But once a SPAC buys a private company, and the company then is public, the original SPAC ticker disappears, and the target company inherits the SPAC's position on the stock market with a brand new ticker. Explain that process for us.
Sure, this is really interesting. It's why most people don't hear about SPACs until many of the biggest gains have been made. Take Vecto IQ, for example. That's a SPAC we talked about earlier, run by a General Motors executive who was researching electric cars. For a while, the SPAC was just a pool of cash with no target in mind, and its stock ticker was VTIQ.
Now, just to be clear, this is the SPAC that was launched by former vice chairman at General Motors, who ended up buying Nikola, the electric truck maker, and then basically taking it public. Do I have that right?
Right, but in the beginning, it was just a pool of cash trading on the NASDAQ under the ticker VTIQ. Unless you knew Steve Gursky, the former GM vice chairman, you probably never would have found out about it. People who knew Steve could have bought shares on that ticker, which automatically gave them pre-IPO-like shares in whatever company Steve would end up choosing. In this case, of course, he chose a startup in Arizona, right here, that makes electric trucks. And when the deal went through, the pool of cash was suddenly a fully vested stake in the new company, Nikola. Soon after, the stock ticker VTIQ disappeared. In its place, shareholders owned the brand new ticker NKLA for Nikola. You could have made six times your money on that deal.
So original stock ticker disappears forever.
Right. Same thing with the other SPAC we discussed with Jim Kiltz earlier, Conyers Acquisition Corp., the one that bought the company behind the Atkins diet. As a SPAC, it traded under the ticker CPAA, but unless you knew the dealmaker, it's doubtful you'd have ever found that ticker and bought shares. That ticker disappeared after the deal went through, and shareholders own the new ticker, SMPL, for the Simply Good Foods Company. And Jeff's SPAC ticker, DEAC, this is Jeff Sagansky, for Diamond Eagle Acquisition, also disappeared. In its place, you'd have received shares in DraftKings, DKNG, the company they eventually took public.
Yeah, that's a lot of very different than a regular stock situation.
Yeah. But of course, keep in mind, SPACs are required to file regular financial statements with the SEC like any other company. But it's not a company like Microsoft, where dozens of media articles come out a day and you can follow all the latest developments. Frankly, you need someone like me who can essentially get you in the room with the deal maker to get the scoop on what the ticker is, what kind of companies are being targeted, and when the deal is has the potential to go through.
Yeah, I've been surprised to see some very mainstream companies go public through a SPAC, by the way, like Hostess Brands, you know, the maker of Twinkies. Which other companies do you expect to go SPAC this year?
Barron's has called 2020 a boom year for SPACs, and it's easy to see why. We've heard a lot of names so far that are considering the SPAC route to go public. Coinbase.
Yeah, Bitcoin company.
Yeah, yep. SoFi, a financial technology company. Robinhood, the trading app. Yep. Even Airbnb has been rumored to go public via SPAC.
All right, so here's another question. Do you think that everyone should be investing in SPACs? I mean, we've talked about how poorly traditional IPOs perform, but does that mean that our viewers should completely give up on ordinary stock investing?
No, of course not. The stock market is still the greatest intellectual game I've ever encountered. And if you know where to look, there will always be plenty of opportunities amongst publicly traded companies. I mean, I once saw the chance to make eight times my money in 10 months on a real estate company, and seven times my money in just over a year on a telecom company. As long as I can find opportunities like that, I won't ever get tired of ordinary stocks. Look, all investing carries the same risk, and past performance is no guarantee of future performance. But the fact is, pre-IPOs and SPACs simply offer more of that kind of upside, in my opinion, with newer companies that still have all of their best years of sales growth ahead of them. I mean, consider a company like Juul. They make electronic cigarettes. Mm-hmm. Not public yet, but pre-IPO shares are up 5,600% in less than 2 years. Tell me how many public companies have seen a return like that.
So if someone watching this is determined to buy shares of ordinary established companies that have been around for years, then
this service may not be suitable for you. An Empire SPAC investor, we're only interested in private companies that go public through the backdoor opportunity known as SPACs. We want bigger gains, faster gains, and more growth potential. If that doesn't sound like you, if you don't realize the upside potential of what we're offering here right now and what a huge bargain you're getting at $2,500 a year for this research, then I can tell you right now, Empire SPAC Investor is not suitable for you, period.
Yeah, and one thing I want to personally add, you might think SPACs are too on the fringe maybe for you to consider, but the fact is I've spent my career sharing some pretty far out deals in this industry with results we're really proud of. For example, I was one of the first people in our industry to demonstrate how selling put options works. And our viewers went on to make a fortune. One man said he was making $10,000 a month. I was one of the first to explain the crypto market. This is back in 2017. I even met with a multi-millionaire crypto founder whose recommendation would have made you 35 times your money if you had gotten in the day we brought it to your attention. 2 years ago, I flew to the backwoods of Vancouver, Washington to break the story of a stock that would have more than doubled your money if you'd gotten in. So often, being the first person into a strange idea is a sure path of making a great deal of money. Now, having said that, I want you to remember the guarantee. Once you take advantage of this charter offer, you'll have 30 days to look over Empire SPAC Investor. And if you're not completely happy, you can get all your money back in the form of a credit that you can apply to any other research service that we publish.
And again, don't be fooled by traditional IPOs. You might think you're getting a great deal investing in a company the moment it hits the stock market, but you're not, my friend. You're not. You're way at the back of the line. Look at a company like Stripe, for example, the credit card processor. The company is 10 years old now, 10 years old, and it still hasn't gone public. Meanwhile, pre-IPO shares are up more than 35,000%, making private investors a killing. And I'm not talking about everyday Americans. I'm talking about Sequoia Capital, Andreessen Horowitz, Tiger Global Capital, the who's who in the hedge fund world. Meanwhile, when do you think Stripe will IPO?
I mean, sometime soon, I would hope.
Wrong. Look at this. A recent Fortune magazine article said, Stripe valuation doubles to $20 billion with no IPO in sight. The CEO recently said, the internet economy is still in its early innings, and yet he still has no plans to go public. And why should he? He can raise all the capital he needs through the private markets. He can expand all he wants to take advantage of Stripe's booming market without any of the headache of dealing with the press, angry shareholders, and all the other hassles of being a public company. Mark my words, by the time Stripe goes public, the biggest gains will be gone. The private investors will be gone too, with multi-bagger gains the average Joe will never see.
So SPACs could end up being the backdoor that millions of everyday Americans have wanted for years to get into the best startups.
Yes, SPACs are by far the easiest way for you to get a piece of the monster gains you hear about with private startups. So don't be a sucker and buy traditional IPOs. You're just handing your money to smart private investors. Stop doing that and get on the other side of the deal. Get your stake before the company goes public. That's what SPACs allow you to do, with as little as $10 a share, with an interest payment if you don't like the deal and a way to get your cash back if you don't want to move forward.
Yeah, it's excellent. Enrique, thank you. Well, we're getting close to wrapping up. One last question. Of all the SPACs that are available in the market right now, why do you think our viewers should invest in Harry Sloan and Jeff Sagansky's new SPAC?
Harry and Jeff are legends. Between them, they've put together truly fantastic SPAC deals in the past and have an ability to tap the wealthiest network of people in America and raise large amounts of capital. This deal has the potential to be huge. Buy your SPAC shares today. Get the warrants that come with it. Then just sit back and let Harry and Jeff do their work. Given what we've seen recently, I wouldn't be surprised to see these shares trading for $50 or $60 within months of their SPAC doing the deal. Remember, once their most recent SPAC, DraftKings, started to attract attention amongst the press in December 2019, it only took the stock 6 months to quadruple. Frankly, Jeff and Harry could hold a press conference any day now that could send this thing soaring. Even before Harry and Jeff's company goes public through the SPAC, it could double by tomorrow just from one leaked word out to the public. And remember, you need my report to learn the full details of getting in, or you risk buying the wrong thing. So if you're interested, I urge you to take advantage of our charter offer now, this hour, this minute, before it's too late.
Awesome. Enrique, thank you so much for joining us. And folks, remember, you can claim 50% off a charter membership to Enrique's new research service, Empire SPAC Investor, plus a free copy of his SPAC Masterclass if you get in today, but you must get in before this charter offer expires. You'll receive Enrique's full model portfolio in the next few minutes. It includes the full details on how to buy into Harry Sloan and Jeff Sagansky's new SPAC deal immediately, plus two more SPAC deals. And then each month for the next year, Enrique will email you a full briefing on his newest SPAC recommendation. Like a pre-IPO, but better, each will have the potential to double or triple your money over the short run and make you 10 times your money or more over the long run with some of the best private companies. You'll receive all the info you need to quickly and easily buy into this deal for as little as $10 per share or even less in some cases, including how to receive those warrants, which again could help you make an extra 100% gain or more on each deal. Remember, Enrique will essentially get you in the room with some of the biggest and best deal makers in America. In the next few minutes, you'll receive your password to the Empire SPAC Investor website, where you'll have the full access to Enrique's new research report, SPACs, How to Make 5 to 10 Times Your Money with the Best Private Deals. Again, including his exclusive behind-the-scenes interview with Harry and Jeff, the multimillionaire businessmen who created the SPAC deal we're sharing today. Plus, you'll receive access to the entire SPAC deal room, which consists of those tell-all interviews with the most powerful SPAC experts in America. And again, he's going to update the deal room every time he has a new interview to add. Enrique will be in touch with you throughout the month to share any important updates, when to add to your position, when to buy, when to sell. Just remember, we're opening access for the first time ever, and we're closing this charter offer soon. So if you're interested, we urge you to get in today before it's too late. You'll save $2,500 off the price. You'll receive our performance guarantee, and you'll get free access to the SPACs Masterclass if you get in today. We'll also give you our 100% customer satisfaction guarantee so you can take the next 30 days to look over Empire SPAC Investor. We think you'll have the chance to make a fortune on the SPAC deals you'll hear about. But again, if you're not happy for any reason, no problem. Simply contact our member services team and you'll receive a full credit refund of everything you pay today. And again, you can apply that credit to any other product published by Empire Financial Research. To get started, just click below. Enrique, thanks for having me.
Thank you, Jared.
And just thank you, Whitney, for joining us today. And a special thanks to Bill Ackman as well for getting on a Zoom call. That was fantastic.
My pleasure, Jared. I'm really excited about this new product and can't wait to launch it. Thanks.
And again, click below to claim your charter membership now. I think you'll find it's more than worth it.
Hi, I'm sure you've all seen the big moves that SPACs are making in the investment markets these days. These stocks can go from a couple dollars a share up to $20, $30 a share almost overnight when they acquire the right private businesses. And Enrique Abeda knows more about these SPACs than anybody else on our team, and I think more than anybody else in the world right now. So I encourage you, if you're interested in speculating in these new SPACs and getting involved in these newfangled IPOs that are making so many people so much money, that you really consider his product carefully. I know he's done a lot of thorough work on all of this research, and I trust him to serve you in the SPAC market.
On behalf of the entire Empire Financial Research team, I'm Jared Kelly, and I just want to thank you for watching.